नारायण नमस्कृत नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरयेत्। रीडिंग फ्रॉम श्रीमद्भागवतम कैंटो 9 चैप्टर नंबर 15 बिगनिंग फ्रॉम वर्स नंबर 12। सो वी आर रीडिंग अबाउट दिस वंशा और डायनेस्टी ऑफ King Ayla, which is Pururava, and then we had the dynasty coming from Kusha. So in the son of Kusambuja was Gadhi, and his daughter was Satyavati. So Satyavati was the only progeny of Gadhi. He had no son at that time. It is later on that Vishwamitra was born, and he got this daughter after great effort, after doing yajna. And she was very beautiful, very qualified, so that's why he was looking for a suitable husband for her. And there came this sage Richik, who comes in the Bhrigu dynasty. So Bhrigu's son was Chavana, and his son was this Richik. And Richik was also looking for a wife, so he went to him and he asked. So the sage, of course, was not a prince and did not have any big facility, and the father did not want to really give, but at the same time he could not say no. So that's when he said that you get me 1,000 horses. But Richik was a very advanced sage, had yogic powers, he has done a lot of tapasya. So he fulfilled the wish. And then we know the story, how Jamdagni was born to him. And so now this is being described here, that when Satyavati said that I should not have son who will be like this, means terrible Kshatriya. So he says, okay, you will have grandson like that. So it was postponed. But Jamdagni himself was also not as peaceful as one would expect. Not like Parshuram, but he was Parshuram's father, you can say. So it's not that Parshuram was the only one who was angry. Jamdagni also had big anger. And there's this famous story that Parshuram has cut off the head of his own mother because Jamdagni asked for that. So what has happened, that one day, because Jamdagni's ashram was somewhere here only, on the bank of Yamuna or close by. So he asked his wife to get water from Yamuna river. In the olden days, people used to drink water from the rivers and ponds because they were clean. There was no industry. Effluence is going into that. No human wastage was thrown into them. So they were clean as they came from the mountain. So she went to get water in the evening time, because he has to do his evening duties, Sandhya Vandan, Gayatri, and he needed water for that. So she went, and when she went there, this Gandharva, who whose name is Chitrupratha, he had come there with his girlfriends to sport inside the river. And Gandharvas are very beautiful and they sing nicely. And Chitrupratha is especially. Anybody remembers his name in Bhagavad Gita? So Krishna says, Gandharva nam Chitrupratha. So he is special. So when Jamdagni's wife, his name was Renuka, she saw this Gandharva, she was very fascinated by him. Especially she was thinking that here is I have my husband who is so angry most of the time. And here look, this beautiful man, and he, they're enjoying. I wish I also could do that. You know, her mind became attracted. And she sat there watching them. And therefore, the time passed for Sandhya. And Jamdagni was waiting. So you can see his name is having the word Agni in it. Fire. So he was waiting, and he thought, well, why is so late? And then when Renuka realized that what has happened, she was very scared because she knew that he will be very angry. He is angry in general. And now she has actually made a mistake. So she came, and when she came, he was waiting. So there are four sons, Vasu, Vasuman, because Parshuram was the youngest. So they were all sitting down for doing their yajna in the evening and chanting Gayatri. So he was angry and he asked, why are you late? So what can she say? And he is a sage, so he also understood. So then he was so angry and he could not tolerate that she was fascinated by another man. So he asked his sons who were sitting, he says, kill her. Just cut off her hand. So these boys, they were surprised to hear anything like this. They knew that, okay, he gets angry, but not to this extent. He shouts, but he has never beaten up or done anything physical like that. So he thought he will cool down after some time and he's not serious about it. Because no one would think that in anger if somebody says kill, then you really do that. So they did not listen to him. And they thought, how can we kill our own mother? And mother is more honorable than father. So Matu Pita Sahasrena Gaurvena Tirichyate. Manu says in Manu Samhita that mother is 1,000 times more respectable than father. So they did not act. And then after some time, Parshuram came. So he has gone to the forest to get some wood for the yajna. So then he came carrying some wood, shami. This. And he had his axe, because that is his weapon. So when he came, the father was still angry, and now he was even more angry because the four sons have disobeyed him. So he told Parshuram that you kill these four brothers and also your mother. Kill all of them. So Parshuram, he took his axe and he chopped off the head of his four brothers and his mother. So So when he did that, then his anger came down, because anger comes when your wish is not fulfilled. And if you achieve the object of your wish, then anger disappears. So now his wish was fulfilled, so he came to normal, and then he saw, what did I do? So he said, I'm so pleased with you, Parashuram, that you did such a terrible act of killing even your own mother and your brothers on my order. So I am very pleased, and I bless you that nobody will be able to defeat you in war, and you will die at your own will. And I am so pleased that you can ask me any boon you want. These two boons I give myself, but if you want, you can take something more. So just as Shantanu has given the boon to Bhishma of Ichha Mrityu, so Parashuram also got from his father. So he said, well, I only want one boon, and that is that please revive my mother and my brothers. And they should not remember anything. So he says, all right, you join their heads to their bodies. So here is Parashuram trying to fix the heads. And of course he did not make a mistake in that, because there were five heads. And then when he did that, then the father brought them back to life. And when they came back to life, they did not know anything what had happened. Rather, they thought that as if they have just woken up from sleep. So they looked at each other. He says, we are sitting here to do Sandhya Vandan and we fell asleep. He says, this is amazing. So let's do it now. So they did not know what Parashuram has done. They had forgotten it. Their memory was wiped out. Not even as if it was a dream or anything like that. So this is Jamdagni and Parashuram. This is the story which he is telling, that Prasaditah Satvatya Maivam Bhud Bhargava Atharhi Bhavet Potro Jamdagni Stato Bhavat. So he said to Satyavati that, Gadhi, that don't worry, you will not have a son like this, but you will have a grandson. And Sacha Bhut Sumahapunya Kaushiki Loka Pavani Reno Sutam Renukam Vai Jamadagni Uha Vahayam. And then it is said that Satyavati, afterward that she went to heaven, Swargaloka. And she became the river herself, Kaushiki River. So this is described, Sacha Bhut Sumahapunya Kaushiki Loka Pavani. So Kaushiki River. And Jamdagni, he married the daughter of King Renu. So he also married king's daughter, like his father. Called Renuka. Tasyam vai Bhargav Rishe Sutaha Vasumadadaya Yaviyan Jagye Etesham Rama Ityabhi Vishruta. So she had five sons. The eldest was Vasumat and Vasu and so on. And the youngest was Parshuram. He is called here as Bhargav Rishi. So he says he was also known as Rama. So there are these three famous Ramas in the history of India. Parashuram, and then Raghav Ram or Dashrathi Ram, and then Balaram. And then the fourth one is Nityananda Ram. So three are popular, fourth one is only known to Gaudiya Vaishnavas. So these are the four Ramas. There is any comment on this? So Sacha Satyavati Kaushiki Nadi Abhut. So Satyavati became the Kaushiki River. And Anina Shadubhavo Bharam Abranyam Dharmakam. So I think it's different sloka. So this Parshuram is supposed to be a Shaktavesh avatar. So that is described here. Yada Yamahur Vasudevansham Hehaya Nam Kulantakam Trishapta Kritvaya Imam Chakre Nikshatriyam Mahi. So he is known as the Ansha or part of Vasudev, and he is the person who brought an end to the Haihaya dynasty. He killed all of them. And then he did not stop, but he killed the Kshatriyas from the earth 21 times. Because it is described, I don't know whether it is in Vishnu Purana or somewhere long ago I read, why he killed the Kshatriyas 21 times. Because when the sons of Sahasra Arjun, Kartavira Arjun killed Jamdagni, then Renuka was weeping and wailing, and see, sometimes when people cry they beat themselves, so she hit her belly 21 times. So Parshuram said, I'm going to destroy the Kshatriyas 21 times. So that's why he did that. So he says, Imam Chakre Nikshatriyam Mahim. So he says that he made the earth free from Kshatriyas 21 times. How is this 21 times? If he made it finished one time, then from where they came second time? So he must have killed some of them, obviously. Because we know that when Parshuram was there, then King Janaka was also there. Right? He is the one who came when Bhagavan Ram broke the bow. Then he came there getting angry. Right? At that time Dashrath was also there. So there must have been some other kings also. Because if you read, then you hear of other kings. So they were all there when Parshuram was there. So definitely Dashrath's father and his father's father and King Janak's father, they were not killed by him. There is no mention that Parshuram killed them.
And all the kings who came for the Swayamvar Sita.
Yeah, so many of them came. So obviously when it is said that Nikshatriyam Mahim he made, so maybe the bad Kshatriyas were killed. That he made the face of earth free from Kshatriyas means bad Kshatriyas. So it is also described that when this Devasur Sangram was going on, the fight between Devas and Asuras, so many of these Asuras who were killed, they were born on earth as Kshatriyas. So they were the one who were behaving in an asuric manner, and Parshuram came to kill them and send them back to the Asura Loka. So that's what he was doing. So dushtam kshatram bhuvo bharam abranyam mani ani nashat rajastamo avritam mahan phalgunyapi kritem hasi. So he says, dushtam kshatram bhuvo bharam brahmanyam aninashat abranyam abramanyam. So here also it is mentioned that he killed the bad kshatriyas, the wicked asuric type of kshatriyas, because dushtam kshatram bhuvo bharam, who were like the burden of the earth. So burden on earth is not something heavy. There are mountains on earth. That is not a burden for earth. So burden on earth is the dushta, the wicked people. So they are the burden, they are heavy, they have to be removed. So abramanyam aninashat. So he destroyed these dusht kshatriyas because they were abramanya. They were disrespectful to the brahmanas, which is the foundation of Vedic culture. Because they are the one who give knowledge, they are the one who educate, and without education, then there is no more varnashram as you can see at present. Because the education system was destroyed, so then this Vedic culture almost disappeared now. Because it is based on education. Because this culture is not based on just economy. It is not some consumerism or socialism or communism. It is not. It has a separate ideology. It is based on principles of moksha, dharma and moksha. And you need education for artha and kama, but you can also do that without much education. But dharma, dharmam to shakshat bhagavat paranitam, vedo akhilo dharma moolam. So dharma you cannot know by any direct perception or by inference. For dharma there is only shabda praman. As Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, tasmat shastram pramanam te. Because dharma is that from where you understand what is to be done and what is not to be done. Karya, karya, vyavasthita. So this can only be known from shastra. Why doing a particular type of charity brings punya and not something else? From materialistic point of view, there may not be any difference. Or why doing charity at a particular time, such as eclipse, gives you more punya. This cannot be understood by any known means. It can only be known from shastra. So therefore, dharma disappears if shastra is not honored. Because dharma is understood from shastra only. Because it is a dharma anushasan coming from shastra. It's a discipline. These are principles which are not based on our empirical experience. So these are the kshatriyas at that time, they became abramanyam. So therefore they have to be removed. That's what Krishna says, dharma sansthapanartha sambhavami yuga yuga. So when the adharma increases, then he comes to bring the balance. So rajastamo vritam, they were covered by rajas and tamas, which means enjoyment and violence. Because there is no enjoyment which happens without violence. Always violence involved in enjoyment, material enjoyment. So he killed them, ahan phalguni api kritehansi. Although there was a small offense on their part, the offense was done by the sons of Kartavirya Arjuna. Kartavirya himself also, but also his sons. because Parshuram killed him, then they came and killed his father. So this enraged Parshuram, and it is difficult to sustain your anger for a long time. So he's special who was sustaining his anger for so long. You get angry, how long you remain angry? If you remain too much angry, you cannot sleep. So Parshuram is a special case that he was angry for years. It's only when he met Bhagavan Ram and Lakshman that he retired. Because they came and they retired him. He was getting angry at them. Then Lakshman got angry. So when he got angry, then Parshuram's anger went down. Because Lakshman is beyond Parshuram. So that's when he took leave.
Babaji?
हाँ जी
एक ग्रामर का प्रश्न अनिनशत ये रूप कहा तो कैसे बना अनिनशत रूप बारम अनिनशत ब्रह्मणि अनिनशत
सो दिस व्हाट इज द प्रत्यावर्य डुप्लीकेट निच 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 प्रत्यय यू नो दिस निच प्रत्यय But niche is no niche is used for something else. There is a pratyaya where the dhatu is duplicated then. So it is nas dhatu.
Isn't that san pratyaya dhatu is duplicated like jingansa?
No, it is not that. There are few pratyayas, but this is niche. Sun and cap, it's not cap also, there is one more. So, or maybe it is niche only, I have to check. It is one of the pratyas where dhatu becomes duplicated and then a becomes e, so it is nas dhatu. And then it becomes aninadas. So, There is a kamu dhatu and kamu becomes achikamat.
Yeah, that is very long form, achikamat. Yeah. Oh, okay, that explains that. This is same than that.
Yeah,
okay.
Actually it is nich only, it is ni pratyaya. Yeah.
Okay.
It is nich pratyaya which has been applied on nas.
Mm-hmm.
And then it becomes aninasat.
Mm-hmm.
So there is saying that अचिकमति न जानाति तस्मै कन्या ने दीयते सो वंस देयर वाज अ ग्रामेरियन एंड ही हैज अ यंग डॉटर सो वन स्टूडेंट ऑफ ग्रामर ही वेंट टू हिम दैट ब्राह्मण बॉय सेज आई वांट टू मैरी योर डॉटर सो ही सेड वेल यू कैन मैरी बट शो मी हाउ डू यू फॉर्मुलेट द वर्ड अचिकमत If you can prove to me which dhatu and which pratyaya and how you form it, which sutra you apply, then you can marry. Because he says, achikamati yona janati, he could not do it. So he says, achikamati yona janati tasmai kanya na diyate. He says, one who does not know how to make achikamat, I cannot give my daughter to him. So aninasat is like that, this niche pratyaya.
Okay. All right, thank you.
So aninasad bhuvo bharam brahmanyam adharmikam. See, Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur says that aninasat means he destroyed or removed the burden of earth. And abrahmanyam means adharmik. These kings, they were not being pious, not following dharma, and driptam kshatram, because they were very proud. So here it is dushtam kshatram, maybe another reading is driptam, proud. So that of course comes when you have power and wealth, then pride is a natural outcome of that. So bharam abramanyam aninashaditi cha paathdvayam. So he says there are two different readings. So in any case, the meaning is that. So Raja Uvacha, then the king, he posed the question. He said, Kim tadangho bhagavato rajan nairajitatma bhihi kritam yena kulam nashtam kshatriyanam abhikshnasaha. So he says, what is the offense they have done to Bhagwan by the kings who were uncontrolled, ajitatma bhi, who were not restraining their senses? Kritam yena kulam nashtam kshatriyanam abhikshnasaha, that he repeatedly destroyed their family. So what did they really do that to incite him to act like that? So then he answers, Shri Sukha Uvacha, Hayanam adhipatir arjuna kshatriya shabha dattam narayanasyansham maradhyay parikarma bhi. So there was a king whose name was Kritavirya, and his son was this Arjuna, also known as Kartavirya Arjuna, means the Arjuna son of Kritavirya. So just like Arjuna, we have Pandav Arjuna, son of Pandu, he was Kartavirya. So he was a great Kshatriya, best of the Kshatriyas, and he was the chief of the Haya dynasty. And Dattam Narayanansham Aradhya Parikarambi. So he was a great devotee of Dattatreya, who is also an avatar of Narayana. So he pleased Dattatreya, doing different types of services to him, parikarmabhi. And by the blessings of Dattatreya, he got many boons. So this Kartavirya Arjun is also a famous person. Just like Pururava, King Pururava is famous, his name is found in the Vedas also. There are also descriptions of Kartavirya Arjuna in the Tantras and how to worship him and get power. He also has some position like that. So Bahun Dashatam Lebhe Durdharsatvam Maratishu Avyahata Indriya Oja Shri Tej Virya Yashobalam. So he, by the blessings of Bhagavan Dattatreya, he got the following things. First of all, he got 1,000 arms. So therefore he is called Sahasra Arjuna or Sahasra Bahu Arjuna, one who has 1,000 arms. And Durdharsatva Maratishu, and he got the boon that his enemies will not be able to defeat him. And he got unrestricted sense power, beauty, prowess, mental strength, fame, wealth, all these things. So he lived for a long time. He was ruling for 20,000 years. And he was very powerful, and people around him, they were all, he was a yogi, he had yogic powers. He did a lot of tapasya, meditation, and then got the blessings of Dattatreya. He was extraordinary, powerful, 1,000 arms means a lot of power. With 2 arms, human being can do a lot of things, right? Imagine that multiplied by 500. You can type so much right? You can have 500 computers simultaneously. Right? There are some people who could write with both hands. I don't know, but there was one Bhagavatacharya. He was a very great scholar. So he could write with both hands on two different topics. So yogeshwaratma aishwaryam guna yatra nimadayah chachara vyahat gatir lokeshu pavno yatha. So he had many yogic powers. Therefore he is called here as Yogeshwara. Yogeshwaratvam aishwaryam. And he has majesty and guna yatra nimadayah. Then he had the yogic powers. Anima, Mahima, Laghima, Garima, all this. So Chachara, therefore he could travel anywhere. Chachara vyahat gatir lokeshu pavno yatha. Just like the wind flowing all around, he could also travel. He could become small, big, heavy, light, right? All these powers he had. So now he shows one of his famous story here. He says, Stri ratnair avritah kridan revambhasi madotkataha vajayantim srajam bibhrad rurodha saritam bhujaihi. So he was surrounded by beautiful women and he was playing in the river Reva, that is Narmada, wearing a Vajanti garland, and with his arms he blocked the water of the river. So the water started flowing up. And viplavitam sushibiram pratishrota sarijjalaihi namrishyattasya tadviriyam viramani dashanam. So it went and it flooded the place where Ravana, who also had 20 arms and 10 heads, he was worshipping Shiva and he had his camp there. So the water started moving up and flooded the camp. So Ravana was very upset. So the story is that when Kartavirya Arjun was getting very famous, Ravana was also going around challenging and defeating, and he went up to Swargaloka and he arrested even the Devas and brought them to Lanka. So at that time he heard about Kartavirya Arjuna. So when he heard, he said, oh, I want to go and fight with him. So he flew in his Pushpaka aeroplane and he came to Mahismatipuri, probably somewhere in Maharashtra, right? Mahismatipuri. Maharashtra is famous for Dattatreya, still. So he came and he went to the Mahismatipuri and he sent messenger, tell Ravana has come, he's challenging Kartavirya Arjun. So the message came, but at that time Kartavirya Arjun had gone for water sport, summertime, feeling hot. So they came and they said, well, now our boss is not here. He's gone for water game. So he says, where has he gone? So they said, he's gone to this Narmada River. So he says, okay, I will go there. So he went, but then he saw this nice place and he said, let's camp here and then I'll check him. So they camped and he decided that before I fight, I will worship Shiva, because he was a Shiva Bhakta. So he was on the bank of the river, he had his Shivlinga, he made arrangements for puja. And in the meantime, the water started coming up and started flooding it. So he says, what is this? The flood should come from above. It is coming from the wrong direction. And there is no rain. So he sent his servants that find out what is happening, why this water is coming up. So they came and they saw that this Kartavirya Arjun, he was playing with these girls and he has blocked the water. So they came back and they told this to Ravana. So Ravana was very upset. That's why it is said, Na Amrishyat Veeramani Dashanana. Veeramani means who thinks himself as a hero. So he was unable to tolerate it. So he sent some of his own people. He says, go and kick this fellow out. I have to do my puja. Otherwise I will go myself. So these people went and they challenged. So he was also king, he also had his servant, they stopped him. He says, come on, don't disturb him. He is having his play now. So there was a fight among them. And these Ravana's people, they defeated them. Then more people came and there was a big fight. Finally, Ravana's people got defeated, they came back. So now Ravana was more angry. So he came and he challenged Kartavirya Arjun. Now if you challenge somebody in front of his girlfriend, then that is the worst time to challenge. If you challenge somebody privately, that is another thing. But to challenge somebody in front of his girlfriend or his wife, then that is intolerable. So you should see the proper time and place. Des kala patra. If you want to challenge somebody, then think of that. So when he did that, then Kartavirya Arjun was, he got very angry. He says, who is this nonsense here? It looks very funny. First of all, he's got 10 heads. So he came out and they started fighting. So both were hero, they fought and they fought. And finally Kartavirya Arjun, he defeated Ravana. He could not kill him because Ravana also had the boon that he cannot be killed like this. So then what Kartavirya Arjun did, that obviously he has so many hands, what is he going to do? What do hands do? Grab. So he caught him and he tied him like a monkey. And then he brought him to his capital. Just like with a rope. Sometimes in India there are these people who go around with the monkey making a show. He says, I will take you to my kingdom and I'll put you in my assembly, you can dance there like a monkey. So that is what is described here. He says, Grihito Lilya Strinam Samaksham Kritakil Vishaha Mahismatyam Sanirudho Mukto Yena Kapiryatha. So Kartavirya Arjun, he caught him just like one catches a monkey easily. Of course, catching monkeys I think is more difficult, so that's not a good analogy. Cannot catch a monkey. But says he caught him easily, Lilya, Grihito Lilya Strinam Samaksham, in front of his women, because that was act of pride for him. He says, look, I'm going to show you now. And that's why he was tying him like a monkey, because he wanted to show to these ladies and just see how great I am. and he brought him Kritkilbisha because Ravana has also disturbed him. He should have waited, but he did not wait. So Saniruddho Mukto Yena Kapiryatha. But then when he tied him and he kept him there, then naturally the news went to Lanka that Ravana is captured. This was a big news. So then news went all the way up to the higher lokas, and Ravana's grandfather is Pulastya, son of Brahma. So Pulastya, when he heard that his grandson has been captured, so he came down. Although he knew that Ravana is acting in an asuric manner, but still attachment to family is strong. So what is that? Sambandho Nirbandho Sambandhinam Munerapi Sudhastyaja. That attachment to relations is difficult to give up even for the munis, like Vyasa, right? Virhakatar Ajuhava Putre Titanme Tatarvo Vinedu Tam Sarubhut Hirdyam Munimanato Asmi. Right? Tam Pravrajantam Anupetam Apeta Krityam. So Vyasa was also running after his son, and he ran for a long time. Finally Sukhdev got the opportunity to disappear because of these girls. These girls were taking bath in the pond naked, and Sukhdev was walking and Vyasa was running behind him. And they did not cover. When Vyasa came, they started covering. So that's where he stopped. And Sukhdev got the chance to. Otherwise the story doesn't tell why he did not get Sukhdev at that time. If he was going after his son, why is that he did not get him? Because he got entangled. He thought, what is this new thing? My son, young man, he was going, and they did not cover themselves, and I'm old man and they're covering. So because he's a philosophical guy, he's a psychologist. So he wanted to know the psychology behind it. Okay, what is the psychology? It's not fitting in my understanding. So that's when Sukhdev disappeared. So here we see that Pulastya, he comes all the way from Brahmaloka to protect Ravana. So when he came, because he is a sage, he is son of Brahma, then Kartvirya Arjuna of course respected him and received him. And he asked him, what can I do for you? He says, well, if you want to do something for me, then release this monkey. He still has to fight with monkeys. Otherwise this whole Leela will not happen. And coming of Rama will have no meaning if Ravana is not there. So he says this, he has a big role to play. His act is not over yet. So that's why it is said that mukto yena kapiryatha. Saniruddho, it means he has bound him. And then mukta means he released him like a monkey. So this is interesting. So why is this being told here, this story, besides to know how the pride acts and how there is a clash of prides? This is to show that this Kartavirya Arjuna was so powerful that he caught Ravana just like a monkey and bound him. So you can understand his power. And this Kartavirya Arjun will be killed by Parshuram, just like you cut vegetable in the kitchen. So that is the, what you call, the ladder. Ravana, Kartavirya Arjun, Parshuram, and then you see Bhagavan Ram. Because Ram is one who put Parshuram down. So this is to show who is Bhagavan, where he stands. So tomorrow we'll read the story why Kartavirya Arjun was killed by Parshuram. If there's any question on this, I don't think there's any commentary.
Babaji, you mentioned earlier in the talk that there is always violence involved in material enjoyment. Can you explain that?
Well, how do you enjoy? You consume something, right? You have to consume some sense object. So you do violence to them. If they are living being, then there is a violence to them, because you have to consume them. And if they are not living being, then you have to also, whether it is fruits, vegetables, human beings, animals. You can see all over this violence going on in the world because of the enjoyment. Right? So whether that is a gross enjoyment or subtle enjoyment, it brings violence.
Like in this same question, little more clarification, Babaji. Like this subtle enjoyment, suppose someone is seeing a beautiful mountain like and appreciating that or enjoying that. So what is the violence in that?
What is the violence in that? Because what happens is that when you enjoy, you actually objectify that. I said yesterday, I think yesterday, that the purpose of beauty is to bring you to God. So from our point of view, mountain, river, everything, they have life. What to speak of human beings? If you want to enjoy human being, then you have to make that human being as an object. Right? He becomes an object, which means matter. So you turn everything into matter. This is the whole material science. That when they are trying to enjoy, they are trying to turn it, everything into an object which we can control and enjoy. But behind everything is life. So you may enjoy the beauty of mountain, but you are also thinking that this mountain is a piece of stone and it is meant for my pleasure. But mountain is also having a life. And it also has purpose, which is not just for your enjoyment. It's also doing good to others. So subtle enjoyment, obviously violence is all not gross as you are thinking. Violence also means to minimize somebody. It's like if you criticize somebody, that is a verbal violence. If you attack through words, so violence, don't always think that you are killing physically, but reducing something to an object.
So earlier I had two questions before Deepakji asked this question. So my first question was that you explained in the beginning that when your wish is not fulfilled, then one becomes angry, like Krishna also says in the Gita. But many times we see that many people whose wishes are not fulfilled, they become depressive. Like they will have a swollen face and like so, off mood kind of thing. So is this a form of anger? Depression?
Yeah, that is a suppressed anger. So that is the anger doing sirsasana. That's why depressed person difficult to become angry, because his anger is doing upside down. If he can get angry, he will get out of depression.
So what? Second question was that like many times this example is given like the wind na pavano yatha, there was a shloka like that as the wind is flowing, so that way. But then like in the science we see that in space it is vacuum, so how do we understand? And they give example like the wind flows to the heaven and etc.
Because your vision is only scientific vision, you should get the Puranic vision. So when you say wind or pavan, you are only thinking of one type of air which you know or science knows. But do you know that there are 47 types or 49 types of airs which will come? 49 marutas? Have you heard of that? So air is just one type you think, but there are many types of air. That's why it is, when you translate then and use another language, it becomes a problem.
Babaji, in a previous class, I remember that you mentioned that Ravana did not literally have 10 heads and 20 arms as you said now. This was just to signify his power. So my question is whether these 1,000 arms of Kartabirya Jr. are also some Atishayokti, which just signify that he's even more powerful than Ravana?
Yeah, I mean, if you want to see it that way, yes, you can think like that. But the way it is being described, obviously he is stopping the river. So even if he has 10,000 arms, how is he going to stop the water? Water will flow in between the arms. Mm-hmm. So it's just to show that he is so powerful. Obviously he must have used yogic power to do that, not just the physical arms. So if he has yogic power to become small, big, maybe sometimes he could manifest 10,000 arms. But there are slokas, I'm not sure, even in Bhagavatam, which actually says that he did not have 10 heads, just has one.
You're speaking of Ravana now.
Yeah, so from that only I'm saying that even this 10,000 arms doesn't really mean that he has to have 10,000 arms.
Yeah, exactly.
But he can manifest if he likes. That is the meaning, that they have yogic power, and if it is needed, then they can manifest.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it means.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay. Yes.
I had one on what came up here was that to objectify something is a type of violence, and my question was that, for instance, in Gita, Krishna describes his vibhutis of mountains and the Himalaya, things like this. So if people with some devotional education see admiring Krishna's vibhutis or the beauties of nature as things that are reminiscent of Krishna or that give them some sort of index of his power, his wonder, his beauty, is that, how conducive is that to the cultivation of bhakti in a pure sense?
No, that is very conducive. That's why I said that I was talking about material enjoyment. So that is remembering Krishna and seeing this as Krishna's manifestation. So you're actually bringing life to it, not making a dead matter. Because there is life behind everything. And ultimate is source of life is He only. So that is very conducive because sarvabhutesu yapasyat bhagavat bhavam atmana. Right? So that is a sign of devotion. Because when you see Him, and your bhav is that.
One small technical question was, this verse you mentioned about even sages having difficulty with attachment and ended in sudhastyaja. I couldn't catch the beginning of the verse. Sudhastyaja, something was the last
one. Munerapi sudhastyaja.
Munerapi. And can I ask one more thing? Just go all the way back to the beginning about Parashuram killing his brothers and his mother. And this, by modern standards, is a very extreme story. So how would you say would be the proper way to see this as having practical application in the life of sadhakas today?
Well, proper application is simple. This is what anger does. I mean, you have to see from different sides. So one side is that the story is trying to tell that impurity comes in the mind. So impurity came in the mind of Renuka, and one of the very important principle of one ashrama system is to keep mind pure, and especially mind of woman, because she is the one who brings both man and woman in this world. She is the mother. And if her mind is polluted, that's why there are more restrictions on women than men. See, the reason that men could have more wives and women had only one husband. Because you have to understand that this was not based on this whole idea that men and women are equal and both can enjoy in the same way. They're not equal in that sense. Women have a very important role to play. She is the mother of society. So therefore it is utmost, just like if you have a field and you want good crop in it, you want to do organic farming, then you don't want that somebody goes and throws some chemical fertilizer there. Right? Or any type of chemical, pesticide, insecticide. Right? You will guard your field like anything. Because you know that if you do that, then it is no more organic. So if you can do that just to get some crop, previously in India, the society was the crop which came from the field of women. And they wanted an organic crop. So therefore they made so many rules and principles for the purity of women, although now there is a lot of protest against all this and equality. Okay, that's fine, I'm not against that. But I'm explaining why it was at that time in the society, what was their thinking. So women was considered as the kshetra, field. And field has to be kept pure for having pure progeny. So impurity is not just impurity of the body. In case of field, it is only physical thing. The real impurity is in the mind. Because when mind becomes impure, then body will also become impure, your actions will become impure. So the sage, he saw that impurity has entered into the mind of my wife. Same thing happened in the case of Gautam and Ahalya. It was not such a big crime. And actually it was not even her mistake, it is Indra who came in the form of Gautama. But still, is thinking that how is that you could not recognize, even if somebody is coming like me. Means purity should be up to that extent. Like a magician, that you are playing a raga, just a little bit change in the note and you can notice that, no, this is, come on, fix your tabla. It's going out of tune. You see how they keep on hitting it and you're wondering, what is it doing, you know? And he goes like this, tick tick, and then he hits again, and he goes tick tick and hits again. We don't see any difference, but he's seeing it. His ears are trained to be so distinctive of the sound. So up to that extent, they were tuning their mind in those days. And that's why the people were born like this now, which for us, these things are impossible stories. We can't believe in them, that somebody could do such a thing or somebody could say and this will happen. But actually there is a truth in them. Besides that, they're teaching a lesson, but such people have lived on this earth. Because human mind has got a lot of capacity. It has immense capacity to achieve things. So at present, the most polluted thing is the human mind. Body we are trying to keep clean, but mind is absolutely polluted now. Because there is no dharma. So that's why Parshuram was killing Abrahmanyam Aninashat. And he said, Dashtam Chatram Bho Bharam Abrahmanyam Aninashat. But he says that these are Dushta Kshatriyas. So Dushta means impure, Dushit. So then they are polluting everything. Now they are the rulers. If the ruler is polluted, then whole population will be polluted. And who can remove the ruler? Nobody has the power, only Brahmanas have the power to do that. So that's what he did. So this is one thing you have to see. And then he was angry, so the other side is that you get angry and the anger does such things. That is another thing, that he had the power to revive. So if you give an order to somebody, you should also have the power that if it does some damage, you are able to handle that damage. Otherwise, don't give such an order. So he also had the power that he could revive after they were killed. So that also has to be seen. Okay. Your question is answered?
Yeah, well, I mean, also what about the perspective of Parshuram? Like, his brothers, as you explained, said...
You see, he saw that. I mean, imagine he came and he saw his father is angry. Right? And he saw that his brothers have not done. So he knows that my father is an angry man. Now if I also refuse, he's going to curse me. Because ultimately when he is angry, what is he going to do? He will curse all of them. He will curse the mother, he will curse the children, including him. So he thought, I will do what he is asking me to do, because I know he has the power to revive. He knew the power also of his father. So he saw that he had options, either to follow the order or not to follow the order. So if he does not follow, he knows that he is in this angry mood, he will definitely curse us. So better I follow and then he will be pleased. And then I'll get him revived. So that's what he did.
One small thing in addition to that would be...
So don't follow that now if some your father asks you to do anything like this.
Yeah, I mean, literally there have been modern situations where gurus are telling their followers to do things in anger like that. But a second part would be, did in Parashuram's mind, could it be said whether he had his own sense of whether it was a proper punishment to be applied to his mother for what she'd done? Was he also aware of what his mother had done?
Yeah, but he knew that this is not a proper punishment. But he was in a situation where he has to take a decision. It was not up to him to decide independent of his father. If he had to take a decision independently, he will not do that, certainly. How can he kill his mother? It's not that he hated her or anything. It's only because of his mother that he goes around killing all these people. When he sees his mother crying for his father's death, that's when he loses his temper. If he has no respect for his mother, he won't care. Okay, Kamala, you have something?
Yeah, I
want to ask. You can throw the mic.
If you say that this Parashuram is a Shaktanishanakar, no?
Mm.
Means that he has a recite mission to fulfill. So then, and also the Dattatreya is also a Shaktanishanakar. So what is his mission?
Giving jnana. Story will come tomorrow. Okay.